Welcome back, my friends. So today we're going to check out another Kurzgesagt video. But before we get into it, let me tell you about the two things I'm creating. Daily Dance Newsletter, completely free newsletter breaking down the latest in science, world news every single day. So if you want that for free, come sign up in the description. I'm also creating a post-quantum VPN, which will theoretically be able to protect you against quantum computers. So the alpha is about to come out. It's going to be free to use, free VPN. So come sign up if you want to get notified when it drops. And that's it. So let's get into the video. Okay, death from space. Gamma ray bursts explained. Here we go.
Imagine if you could gather the energy from every star within 100 million light years, from thousands of galaxies, each with billions of stars. Imagine you could take this kind of power and use it to fire the biggest superweapon in the universe. Imagine the damage you could do. It turns out, you don't need to imagine it. These exist, and they're called gamma ray bursts. But what are these cosmic snipers? And what happens if one takes a shot at Earth? To understand gamma ray bursts, we first have to understand gamma rays. Gamma rays are electromagnetic radiation, waves which carry energy just like visible light. Visible light is a tiny part of the electromagnetic spectrum. It's the part your eyes can see. At lower energies, there are radio waves, microwaves, and infrared. And at higher energies, ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays.
If you're wondering where the name gamma rays came from, it came from Ernest Rutherford, New Zealand dude. And we first, you know, I think identified them in the, you know, 1900, which from radium, you know, isolated by Marie Curie and Pierre Curie a few years before. And when we first studied how atomic nuclei like change form, they basically identified three types of radiation based on how far, like they penetrated into this barrier made of lead, right? And Ernest named this radiation for the first three letters of the Greek alphabet. So alpha rays basically bounced right off, beta rays went a little further, gamma rays went the furthest, right? And today, basically, we know that these alpha rays are the same thing as helium nuclei, two protons, two neutrons. Beta rays are either electrons or positrons. Positrons, you know, antimatter version of the electron. And gamma rays are like a kind of light.
Gamma rays are incredibly powerful. A single gamma ray photon is more energetic than a million visible photons.
You didn't know Hulk was a physicist in his human form. So a fun little fact, but doctors actually do brain surgery with these gamma ray knives, right? And these gamma rays are helpful, but you know, they can also be very harmful. They're just, you know, don't worry, they're pretty unlikely to turn you into the Hulk. So with this gamma ray knife, you can basically destroy cancer and other, you know, fix other problems. And so we sometimes use this knife, which is like a lot of beams that's focused on these cells that need to be destroyed. And because each beam is relatively small, like it, you know, it does not too much damage to healthy brain tissue, right? But where they're focused, the amount of radiation is so intense that it kills cancer cells. And since brains are like fairly delicate, this gamma ray knife, you know, is safer than, you know, trying to do you know, surgeries on the brain with like a scalpel.
Combined, their high energy makes gamma rays a form of ionizing radiation, meaning they are energetic enough to break apart atomic bonds. This makes them dangerous to you and me. Ionizing radiation disrupts the delicate biochemical machinery that keeps us alive, like a 9mm bullet through a clock.
Another really interesting thing to think about is how gamma rays actually kind of indirectly give life to Earth. So like hydrogen nuclei are always fusing together in the core of the sun, right? And when this happens, one byproduct is gamma rays. And the energy of that gamma ray basically keeps the sun's core hot. And some of those gamma rays also escape, you know, into the sun's outer layers, where they collide with electrons and protons and they, you know, lose energy. And as they lose energy, they basically change into ultraviolet, infrared, and visible light. And, you know, that infrared light basically keeps Earth warm, and the visible light, you know, sustains plants, and there you go.
Fortunately, on Earth, the ozone layer blocks gamma rays, filtering them out before they can harm us. But if the atmosphere blocks gamma rays from space, how were gamma ray bursts, or GRBs, from space ever discovered? During the Cold War, the USA sent up spy satellites which could detect gamma rays from Soviet nuclear tests in space. They didn't see any bombs, but they did observe faint bursts coming from space, lasting only a few seconds. To date, this may be the only major scientific discovery made by spy satellites, that we know about anyway. Astronomers use telescopes that see different kinds of light to make their discoveries, and these spy satellites gave them a new pair of eyes. They were a mystery for 30 years, but eventually we discovered the source of a GRB, a galaxy 6 billion...
Everybody loves a good mystery, and there's quite a bit more to this story than Kurzgesagt said, so let's talk a little bit about it. Like, these gamma ray bursts, right, were discovered in the mid-1960s, and, you know, by accident, because the US government was trying to spy on the Soviet Union to see if they were breaking a treaty that was in place at the time that banned nuclear devices in space. And they're probably just trying to see if they were just, you know, setting off nukes anywhere as well. And what they did, so they launched these Vala satellites, right, that could detect gamma rays, because nukes do release some gamma rays. And they immediately noticed that there were gamma rays coming from everywhere. And they're like, they're pretty suspicious about this, right? There's a lot of wild theories going around. A lot of people, because we didn't know what they were, you know, people were allowed to speculate freely, of course. So there was wild theories, like, you know, they were coming from within the solar system and like wild stuff. And but we basically, luckily, you know, the way the gamma rays are distributed from a cosmic origin is different from, like, if they come from nukes. So that's pretty lucky. Otherwise, you know, who, maybe World War III would have started. So yeah, we knew there was something not quite right, and they had to be coming from elsewhere. And, you know, eventually we realized they're coming from some of the place in the cosmos, and that spawned, like, a new age of astronomy. The explosions, like, seemed to pack more energy than a supernova, right? And they were totally unpredictable, you know, coming from any and all parts of the sky at random, and then, like, just strange times. They're also pretty brief, like, some last only a split second, and by the time, you know, observers move the telescope in the direction, it was gone.
If a GRB can be seen from such a distance, then it must be incredibly energetic, releasing more energy in a second than the sun will in its entire 10 billion year lifetime, making GRBs the brightest events in the universe. So where do they come from? GRBs accompany some of the most violent cataclysmic deaths in the universe and the birth of black holes.
Some gamma rays actually come from thunderstorms. Like in 1990, some, you know, observatories in space basically detected that these gamma rays, some of them were coming from Earth, right? And they were eventually traced to thunderclouds. And so we think that when static electricity builds up in, like, clouds, you know, that's when you get lightning. That's what we think, right? And that static electricity can also act like as a giant particle accelerator, which creates, like, pairs of electrons and positrons, and they annihilate into gamma rays, and there you go. And these bursts happen so high in the air that only planes are exposed to them. And so that's why, another reason, you know, planes stay away from storms.
There are two types of gamma ray burst, short and long, and each has their own source. Long GRBs last about a minute, and scientists think they are produced by supernova, when the core of a massive star collapses to become a black hole. Short GRBs last a second, and are produced when two neutron stars in a binary merge. Over millions of years, their orbits decay by emitting gravitational waves. Once they're close enough to touch, they crash and splash into each other, forming a black hole.
We actually think that's where a lot of heavy elements come from, such as gold. We think most of the gold in the universe comes from merging neutron star. Next time you look at a piece of gold, just think neutron star.
Both supernova and neutron star mergers make the same thing. Black holes surround...
Supernovas don't always form black holes, by the way. They can result in neutron stars.
...bounded by a magnetized disk of gas left over from their parent stars. In these environments, the rotation winds up the magnetic field, which funnels hot jets of particles traveling at nearly the speed of light. The gas in this funnel creates two tight jets of high-energy gamma rays, like a celestial laser gun. So unlike other cosmic explosions which spread out and fade, GRBs stay focused and can be seen from much further. Any more detail would require too much mathematics for a YouTube video. The universe.
All right, well, then how about we give some more detail? But the physics behind, you know, these long gamma ray bursts was first put forth by a physicist called Stan Woosley, right? And that's the collapse R model is like pretty much regarded as the leading explanation of these long gamma ray bursts. So I should also add that these collapse Rs are also known as hypernova, and they're thought to be like the result of like an extreme core collapse star death, because they're essentially some of the most energetic supernova in the universe. The short ones are a bit more of a puzzle still. They're pretty much just on and off too quickly to be supernovas, and the energies, like, they don't add up to an exploding star. So a lot of people think they're caused instead by, like, you know, older neutron star collisions, or maybe neutron stars colliding with black holes. Basically, we still just don't know. They're still a mystery, and there's still a bunch of other mysteries with them as well. Like, all types of galaxies contain at least, you know, a few massive stars that are, you know, ready to explode, right? So we expect to see these gamma ray bursts coming from spiral galaxies, elliptical galaxies, barred galaxies, you know, all of it. But they only seem to prefer like irregular galaxies over all the others. And we can't explain this just yet. Another example is like the first waves of star formation after the Big Bang should have produced like a heap amount of supernova explosions, you know, that release gamma ray bursts. Yet there seems to be a lack of these explosions at those redshifts corresponding to that, you know, early epoch. So where are these missing gamma ray bursts? Who knows?
The universe is full of these cosmic snipers, firing blindly and randomly.
I love that, cosmic snipers. I've never really thought about it like that. Yeah, hopefully we don't get headshotted.
Into the dark, and they're hitting us all the time. On average, we detect one per day. Fortunately, most are harmless. All the bursts we have detected so far originated outside the Milky Way, too far away to hurt us. But a nearby GRB could be disastrous. If one goes off within a few light years of us, it would totally cook the surface of the Earth, or at least the half that's facing it. But
or at least, you know, do a lot of damage to our atmosphere.
Even a more distant GRB could still end life on Earth. And it wouldn't need to score a headshot to kill us. If originating from a few thousand light years away, it would be 100 light years wide by the time it reaches us, washing over the solar system like a tidal wave. Again, the ozone layer protects us, but it's better equipped to handle the trickle of ultraviolet from the sun. A gamma ray burst would overwhelm it, leaving us exposed to deadly solar radiation. Ozone takes years to replenish itself by natural processes, which is more than enough time for the sun to burn the Earth sterile, or at least to kill most complex life. In fact, this may have already happened. A GRB has been suggested as one possible cause of the Ordovician extinction 450 million years ago that eradicated almost 85% of all marine species, although it's pretty much impossible to prove.
If you enjoy stuff like this, we did talk quite a bit about in the Halo video, where I tried to come up with ways you could create like a Halo weapon which kills everything in the galaxy, and we talk about stuff like this, but we're going to talk about some different stuff.
Gamma ray bursts could even be one reason we don't see life anywhere else in the universe. They might be wiping clean huge
could be one of the great filters
chunks of it on a regular basis. It's been suggested that because of GRBs, only 10% of all galaxies might be hospitable to life similar to us. So are they going to kill us?
If you're wondering why it's 10%, it's because our galaxy isn't very active. It's not what you call an active galactic nuclei, where there's lots of new stars forming. In those galaxies where new stars are forming, which, you know, are much earlier in the universe, not in our present local universe, there's a lot of activity. There's a lot of young stars that are very temperamental, doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And, you know, even our galaxy doesn't even have that many stars. There's lots of galaxies that have way more stars, way more crammed, and way more dense. So you can imagine, you know, there's a much higher chance of a star near you going supernova if that's the case.
Probably not. In a galaxy like ours, there may only be one GRB per millennia. And to harm us, they must be close and directed at us. But since gamma rays travel at the speed of light, we won't know one is headed our way until it arrives. So there could already be a GRB on its way to kill us all, and we won't know it until it hits us and we're dead.
Gotta love that ending. That was a great ending. He usually ends them on a positive note. That was a bit more like, ha, like, you know, you
Might be already dead and you don't know it.
Some of these suckers are like scary bright. Like some of them are so bright and so far away that we're picking them up, but we can't see the host galaxy that they're in. And, you know, we're pretty sure they're in a host galaxy, but it's just so far away, there isn't a telescope on Earth capable of detecting it. Not even the JWST. For example, we know there's a star capable of having a gamma ray burst that formed just 500,000 years after the Big Bang. That's super close, you know, to when the cosmic microwave background radiation was released about 380,000 years after the Big Bang. So if you want to know what would happen if a supernova or a hypernova went off in our galaxy, if you want to know how close they've got to be to destroy us, you should go check out that Halo video, because we go right into it and we talk about what would happen to our atmosphere. And that's basically because those Halo weapons in that game, that's what they're used for. So we try to, you know, do some math. So you should go check out that video if you want to hear about that.